I'd like to think Jesus is a great person. It's a silly story.
It's idolization, basically, the idea that there's a human being that can be viewed as a god.
I believe that the teachings of Jesus, they ring true to me. It makes sense to live that way.
Jesus, I believe, was a liberal. And I think, looking at where we're going, I think he'd be happy to see that people are becoming more and more accepting.
I think I grow more curious about that every day, and how I can be a better person, maybe by following his teachings. And maybe it will be a fit for me, and maybe it won't. But, you know, I have a lifetime to figure that out.
Well, is Jesus really God? That's a provocative question, isn't it? Is Jesus really God? Before we get too much into that, I want to share a story with y'all. You are not going to know this by looking at me, but I used to be obsessed with my hair. I was very much into my hair in high school. It was the only thing that made me even remotely cool. But what I struggled with most when I started losing my hair was my mother's explanations as to why I was losing my hair. You may have had explanations from your mom about crazy things, and I don't know why moms do this, but they always have these outlandish explanations. For example, when I started thinning out on top, she said it was because I was using too much hair gel and hair wax, because I was really into it. Then it progressed from there, and she said, well, maybe your showers are too hot, Andrew. Maybe the water is burning the hair out of your head. And then the culmination of all of her explanations was that I was wearing too many hats, and so sunlight was preventing growth. Like, I wasn't getting enough sunlight, as though it was like a chia pet or something, right? Like, these explanations were just outlandish. But my mom felt the need to come up with an explanation for all of these things, because she couldn't just accept that I was going bald at the age I was. Now, Jesus is someone that people love to come up with an explanation about, because he is such a polarizing figure, isn't he? Throughout history, people have looked at Jesus, the story of who he is, the stories about what he did, and they've needed to come up with an explanation. Who was Jesus? We've just watched some clips there of different thoughts about who Jesus is. And there is no shortage of ideas about him. We have said lots of different things about Jesus. Even in other religions, there are ideas about who he is. If we go to Islam, Jesus is a prophet called Yesu. If we go to Hinduism, he is a wise teacher. If we go to Buddhism, Jesus is an enlightened man who knew more about the universe than we did. And even in secular culture where there's no belief in a divine God, there are things to be found about Jesus. He's a good teacher. He taught us about morality. He taught us how to love our neighbor. And even during his lifetime, there was questions about who he was. The people that he walked with wondered, who is this person who says these things, who does these things? If you turn with me to the book of Mark in the Bible, there's an account in which Jesus is spending time with his friends, and he kind of picks up on all of these things that are going on around him, all these explanations that people had. He says in Mark 8 that he was with his disciples going to the villages of Caesarea and Philippi. And on the way, he asked his disciples, who do people say that I am? And they told him, John the Baptist, and others say Elijah, and others say one of the prophets. And he asked them, but who do you say that I am? And Peter answered, you are the Christ. The Christ meaning that you are the Son of God. So there are many explanations, but the one that causes the most drama and the most curiosity is that, is this person really God? We've been doing Explore God now for 5 weeks, and we've asked some of the most provocative questions that are out there about God. We've looked at pain and suffering. Last week we looked at, is Christianity too narrow? And now we're looking at Jesus himself. You've probably noticed, if you've been with us this whole time, we're kind of narrowing in on some of the more detailed questions. And today I want to look at Jesus, but I don't want to look at what we say about him. I don't want to look at what the world says about Jesus. I want to go straight to what Jesus says about himself. Because in all these explanations that we come up with about who he was and why he was here, very rarely do we just look at what he said and what he did himself. So I want to look at three things together. I want to look at the uniqueness of his claims, I want to look at the uniqueness of his deeds, and I want to look at the uniqueness of his resurrection. And I want to talk first about his claims. Now, when I was in college, I was often the token foreign friend. And so when I would be introduced to people that I'd never met before, they would say, "This is Andrew, he's English." Right? As though that was the only interesting thing about me. And so there was this one occasion that my friend took me along to a party, and there was someone at the party who was a little bit of an Anglophile. They really loved England, loved Britain. So my friend thought, "I'll introduce Andrew to this person." So he took me along and said, "This is Andrew, he's English." And this person just kind of looked me up and down, and he says, "Where are you from?" I said, "Well, I'm from North England, I'm near Newcastle." And I can see as he's listening to me speak, he just kind of, there's some kind of look on his face, and as soon as I'm done, he says, "You're not really from England." And at that point, you say, I don't know what to say. I'm like, "I am. I can make you a cup of tea and prove it if you want." Like, what do you do at that point when you're claiming something about yourself that you know is true, that is a part of who you are, and someone's questioning that? That was Jesus' life. Jesus made very bold claims about himself, and he faced questions about it. If we go to the Gospel of John, there's one account in particular that is extremely provocative. Jesus is in Jerusalem, and this is what it says in chapter 10, verse 22. "At that time, the Feast of Dedication took place at Jerusalem. It was winter, and Jesus was walking in the temple in the colonnade of Solomon. So the Jews gathered around him and said to him, 'How long will you keep us in suspense? If you're the Christ, tell us plainly.' And Jesus answered them, 'I told you, and you don't believe. The works that I do in my Father's name bear witness about me, but you don't believe because you are not among my sheep. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of the Father's hand. I and the Father are one.' The Jews picked up stones again to stone him, and Jesus answered them, 'I've shown you many good works from the Father. For which of them are you going to stone me?' And the Jews answered him, 'It's not for a good work that we're going to stone you, but for blasphemy, because you, being a man, make yourself God.'" It's very easy for us in our culture, in our time, when we're quite removed from the period in which Jesus lived, to start thinking things about him that really Jesus never said. Because what Jesus claimed about himself was that he was God. Jesus unquestionably believed that he was God in the flesh. He wasn't just a religious teacher. He wasn't just a Jewish rabbi. That this was God walking amongst us. And it's not just a singular occurrence in which Jesus did this. It's not just a one-off time where he alluded, maybe he's God. He says it again and again and again. Which is why the reaction to him saying things like this is so violent. Jesus says this, and immediately they pick up stones because they want to throw them at him. They want to stone him to death for what he said. And on this particular occasion, in this passage we've just read, they start by saying to him, "Can you be plain with us? If you really are the Christ, if you're the Messiah, if you're the chosen one come to rescue us, just tell us plainly." And what Jesus says to them is very interesting. He says, "I have told you, but you just don't believe me. I've been really plain with you." Now, it's interesting that they would ask that, isn't it? That Jesus is saying to them, "I've been really plain about who I am." And they're saying, but really though, who are you? Think about it this way. If I was to stand in front of you today and say, "I'm God," the most gracious amongst you would probably say, "Oh, it's like a metaphor or an analogy. He doesn't really mean that he's God. Maybe he's just trying to teach us something about God by kind of personifying it for a moment." Now, that's probably the situation that the Jews found themselves in with Jesus, because it was just so radical, so crazy to think that this person could be God, that if Jesus stands in front of them and says, "Yes, I'm God," they think that that's some kind of metaphor. They think that Jesus is not really being plain with them. He's just kind of dancing around it and being clever. But Jesus says, "No, I am being plain. That is who I am." And so their reaction becomes really violent. On another encounter, very similar to this one, Jesus is again out and about walking with people, teaching them about who he is, and they ask him again who he is, and he says, "Before Abraham was, I am." In John 8:58, he says, "Before Abraham was, I am." Now, that's kind of an odd way to answer a question. It's an odd phrase. Why doesn't he say, "Before Abraham was, I was"? Well, Jesus is trying to say two things about himself. And to the Jewish person in this culture, they would know exactly what he's saying. The first is he's saying that he's timeless, which is a characteristic that only God has, right? That Abraham, a man who lived 2,000 years before the birth of Jesus, that Jesus is saying, "I predate him. I was around before him." Well, only God can be eternal. But even more than that, when he says, "Before Abraham was, I am," Jesus is doing something really specific. You see, that "I am" is a name that the Jews had given to God that had come about when Moses was at the burning bush. If you remember the story of Moses at the burning bush, God introduces himself by saying, "I am that I am." And so from that point on, that phrase, that name for God became incredibly holy and sacred. That's how the Jews knew who God was. Yahweh was known as the great I am. And what Jesus does in this moment is he says, "That's me. The one who appeared in the bush to Moses. The one who spoke to your father Abraham. The one who was before all and in all. That's me. I am the great I am." And the reaction is exactly the same. They pick up stones immediately to stone him. This tends to happen a lot to Jesus. Because people were so thrown back by what he was saying about himself. The most dramatic is right at his trial. See, Jesus goes on to say this again and again, and it comes to the end of his ministry. After preaching about himself for about 3 years, the religious authorities can't take it anymore. They can't handle that this man really thinks that he's God, and so they come to him by night and have him arrested and pull him in to give him a trial. And they give him one more opportunity to recant these ridiculous claims that he's God. And it says in chapter 14 of Mark that the high priest stood up in the midst of this trial and asks Jesus, "Have you no answer to make? What is it that these men testify against you?" But he remained silent and made no answer. And again the high priest asked him, "Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed?" And Jesus says, "I am. And you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming with the clouds of heaven." And the high priest tore his garments and said, "What further witnesses do we need? You've heard his blasphemy. What is your decision?" And they all condemned him as deserving of death. Even in the face of possible execution, Jesus doesn't change what he says about himself. And that tells us a lot about how deeply convicted Jesus was about who he was. See, Jesus knows that if he says this, if he says that he is the Son of God, that the high priest is going to tear his robe in shock and horror, that the crowd is going to be incensed against him, that he's going to be dragged outside, and he is going to be executed for what he has said. But he doesn't change. And even further than that, what's so incredibly dramatic about this occasion is that what Jesus says is, not only am I the Son of God, but I am going to come on the clouds of heaven. You're going to see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power. What Jesus is saying is, this trial that we're in right now, this testing of me and these questions that you're asking about me and judging me, I'm actually going to be the one that judges you for your life. I am actually the God who determines your eternal fate. I'm going to come on the clouds of heaven because I am the eternal judge. You see, when we think about this question, is Jesus really God? The place that we have to start is that no matter what we think about Jesus, he undoubtedly thought he was God. This man in history who we can look at Jewish and Roman records of, he believed that he was God. And C.S. Lewis makes this very famous statement about this very idea in his book, Mere Christianity. He says, "I'm trying to prevent anyone saying the really foolish thing that people often say about Jesus. They say, 'I'm ready to accept Jesus as a great moral teacher, but I don't accept his claim to be God. That's the one thing that we must not say. A man who was merely a man and said the sort of things that Jesus said about himself would not be a great moral teacher. He would either be a lunatic on the level of with a man who says that he's a poached egg, or else he would be the devil of hell. You must make your choice. Either this man was and is the Son of God, or else a madman, or something even worse. You can shut him up for a fool, you can spit at him and kill him as a demon, or you can fall at his feet and call him Lord and God. But let us not come with any patronizing nonsense about him being a great human teacher. He has not left that open to us. See, what C.S. Lewis is saying is either we buy into everything that Jesus says about himself, or we have to reject him entirely. Either Jesus is telling the truth and he really is God, or he is a lunatic or a liar. Any man who says these kinds of things shouldn't be revered, they shouldn't be admired, unless they are telling the truth. Jesus is quite literally saying, you can't call me your good teacher unless you think that I'm God. And sometimes even amongst Christians, we kind of play with this idea of God being, or Jesus being something just a little bit less than God. Because if he's really God, then what does that mean for us? What does that mean about the way we're going to react to the things that he said and did if he was telling the truth? Now, I want to be fair. Jesus saying that he's God doesn't really provide us much in figuring out whether that's true or not. We know that Jesus believed it, but what do we have to determine whether he really is telling the truth? Well, we have the uniqueness of his deeds. There is a former student from our church who is an incredible magician called Dryden Glod. And rather than try and explain some of the amazing things he does, I would love to show you a short clip of how good he is. So let's watch this real quick.
Got some lifesavers. I'm going to let you have one here.
Beautiful.
Go ahead. I eat these in a weird way. Let me show you what I mean.
I put it in my mouth. Am I supposed to do that?
Watch this.
That's nasty.
That makes me so grossed out. But isn't that amazing? When you watch that, aren't you immediately led to say, how did he do that? How did he make that happen? Like, we know that that's an illusion. We know that there is some kind of explanation behind that. But when we see it, we just don't know what to say. And every time I see Dryden and he does a trick for me, I always say, you got to tell me how you did that. You got to do that over and over until I work it out, because what you've just done is so amazing. There's got to be an explanation for that. Now, Jesus is not a magician, and I'm not trying to say he's anything like Dryden, but he did do things that people could not explain. Jesus did things to where the reaction was to say, how did you do that? How did you accomplish what you just did? I want to read from you an account from the chapter 2 of the Gospel of Mark. And one of my favorite accounts of Jesus' miracles is where he heals a man who's paralyzed. It says, starting in verse 5, when Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, son, your sins are forgiven. Now some of the scribes were sitting there questioning in their hearts, why does this man speak like that? He's blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God alone? And immediately Jesus, perceiving in his spirit that they were thus questioned within themselves, said to them, why do you question these things in your hearts? What is easier for me to say to the paralytic, your sins are forgiven, or to say, rise, take up your bed and walk? But that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins, he said to the paralytic, I say to you, rise, pick up your bed and go home. And he rose and immediately picked up his bed and went out before them all, so that they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, we've never seen anything like this. Now, the reason I love this passage so much is Jesus is very, very bold about who he thinks he is in this moment. And not only does he make a statement about it, but he gives us evidence to think about why he is telling the truth. This is relatively early in Jesus' ministry. This is before those conversations we've already looked at. And what's happening is that he comes in to heal a man, and the way that he chooses to do that is to say, your sins are forgiven. Now, the religious teachers in the room, very rightfully so, immediately react to this and say, how can he say that? Because only God can forgive sins. So this person is implying that they're God by saying that they can forgive sins. The reason why they're right to do that is ultimately all sin, the idea of sin, is things that we do against God. It's things that only he can forgive us for. For example, if I took your car out for a joyride and rather recklessly crashed it, the only person who could forgive me for having done that is you, because it's your car and the wrong has been done to you. And it's the same with sin. In the Bible, we're taught that what sin is it's an offense against God. It's crimes against God. So I can't forgive people of their sins because it's not really against me. Ultimately, even sins committed against one another are against God, because we're disrespecting the image of God within people. So if God is the only one who can forgive sins, then if Jesus says, I'm going to forgive your sins, Jesus is saying, I'm God. And they react to this immediately. They say, he can't say that. That's blasphemy. Now Jesus pauses. And I want to highlight for a minute that no one has said anything out loud at this point. It's not that they shout this. It says that they just question it within themselves. They just kind of go, how can he do that? And Jesus knows exactly what they've just thought, which is by itself miraculous, that Jesus knows what someone is thinking without them saying it out loud. He just looks and knows immediately. And he responds to their question and he says, what's easier for me to do? To say it, exactly who I am and do that, or to say, pick up your bed and walk and prove to you that I am exactly who I say I am? And that's what he does. He says, pick up your mat and walk. And he forgives the man's sin and he heals him, thus proving that when he says he was God, he really meant it. And Jesus goes on to do this again and again and again. Jesus doesn't really give us a shortage of evidence to believe that he really is who he says he is. On another occasion, Jesus is on a boat with his disciples. Another famous story. He's sailing across the Sea of Galilee, and a storm arises. It's a terrible storm. The boat is being shook from side to side. And the disciples, who are experienced fishermen, who know exactly what a real storm looks like, are terrified that they are going to die. And they go to get Jesus, who's taking a nap in the back of the boat because he's weird. And they manage to wake him up and they say, Jesus, we're going to die. What are you going to do about this? We're going to die in the middle of this storm. And Jesus very calmly arises, goes to the front of the boat and says, peace be still. And immediately in that instant, the wind and the waves stop and go silent. And at that point, when we read the Bible, we're told that the disciples become more afraid of Jesus than they ever were of the storm, that they become terrified of this man, and they say about him, what sort of man is this that even the wind and the waves obey him? I think I would ask that same question. Because how could that possibly be an illusion? Experienced fishermen who know exactly what a storm looks like, who knows what it feels like to be in the middle of choppy waters, and then this man steps up, speaks to the weather, and it does exactly what he says. See, Jesus doesn't just show that he has power over sickness and disease and sin. He shows that he has power over nature itself. That wind and waves obey him says something very incredible about who he is. The last thing that I really think is interesting about his deeds is that even his enemies don't deny that he did what he did. If we look at an account from something called the Babylonian Talmud, which is a Jewish writing from the period in which Jesus was alive, they actually mention Jesus. And this is what they say about him. It says, on the eve of the Passover, Yeshu was hanged. And for 40 days before the execution took place, a herald cried, he is going forth to be stoned because he has practiced sorcery and enticed Israel to apostasy. Now, Yeshu, that name that we read in there, was Jesus' Hebrew name. So this is who they're speaking about. They are speaking about Jesus. And I find it so interesting that they say he practiced sorcery. Why would they say something like that? It's because they were seeing him do things that defied explanation. And this is not an account from the Bible. This is an account from someone who does not believe that Jesus is who he says he is. And they don't deny that he was doing miracles. They just deny how he was doing them. See, for them, they couldn't accept that it was because he was God. There had to be some other explanation. It must be that he's an illusionist or a magician or a sorcerer, but never once did they deny that he did miraculous things. And wouldn't that be the easiest way to put this all to bed? To say, that never really happened. That story on the boat, someone just made that up. But Romans and Jews and extra-biblical sources we have all speak of Jesus as being someone who did amazing things that defied explanation. So I think when we think about this question of whether Jesus is really God, we have to start looking at the evidence and thinking about what this is really pointing to. If a man was capable of doing things like this, could one man really fool hundreds, if not thousands, of people around him into thinking that he was God? How could one man come up with enough food to feed 5,000 people and fool them into doing that? If there was some explanation behind that, wouldn't someone find that? Wouldn't someone in the 3 years that Jesus was doing this find some other explanation and say, oh, it's all a hoax? We've got to be careful not to look back on these people and think, well, they were easily duped because they were ancient people. These were not fools. They were people around who knew what dead people looked like. They weren't being fooled into Jesus raising the dead. They knew about this. They saw this. They knew what the people that were being healed were their friends and their family. But despite all of these things that we look through, people still struggled. So if you still struggle with this, I want you to breathe a sigh of relief. I'm not in any way accusing you of missing something, because people in this day who saw these things and saw him say these things still struggled. They would ask for one more miracle, one more sign, because it just couldn't be the case that he was God. And Jesus responded and says, I'm going to give you just one more miracle. And he says, just as Jonah was 3 days and nights in the belly of the great fish, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. Jesus here is speaking about his death and his resurrection and saying, this is going to be the last and greatest miracle that I give to you to show you who I really am. So let's look at the uniqueness of his resurrection, because this is most definitely the most definitive evidence, I think, of who Jesus is. It is why I have the conviction of who he is. I don't believe it blindly. I don't believe in Jesus because I hope it's real. I believe in it because I think that there is definitive evidence to suggest that he really was who he says he is. In John chapter 20, this is what we read about Jesus following his resurrection. It says, now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, we've seen the Lord. But he said to them, unless I see the marks in his hands and the nails where they were, unless I place my finger into the mark of the nails and place my hand into his side, I will never believe. I will never believe that Jesus is who he says unless I see him in front of me and I can touch it. And 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. And although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. And then he said to Thomas, put your finger here and see my hands, and put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe. And Thomas answered him, my Lord and my God. Thomas is often called the doubter, if you've ever heard his story before. And I think that's important for us, because Thomas is a perfect case example then of someone who has heard what Jesus said, who's seen him do miraculous things, but still in his heart questions and says, who is this man? Yet when Jesus appears after his resurrection and comes to Thomas, Thomas falls on his knees and said, my Lord and my God. This is not Thomas just saying, this is my friend raised from the grave. This is not just another miracle that Jesus has done. This is God in the flesh. Only God could do what Jesus has now done. And it only grew from there. It wasn't just Thomas that started confessing Jesus as God. The rest of the disciples, even Jesus' family, which the Bible records as having called him a lunatic when he started saying that he was God, now bend the knee and worship Jesus as God himself. His brother James wrote a letter in the New Testament, not only saying that he worships Jesus as God, his own brother, but that he's urging others to do the same thing. The surge of belief that came from Jesus' resurrection is the ground on which all of Christianity was built. It was so powerful that even now, over 2,000 years since this supposedly occurred, we're still talking about this great man. And there are teachers from only 200 years ago that we probably didn't even know existed. Simple men who walked with Jesus became willing to die for the belief that he was God. It's easy to look on that and say, well, it was all an elaborate ruse. But when we think about what kind of conviction it takes for a man to give up his life for something, what does that tell you about how deeply he believes it? And Jesus' resurrection, by the way, is not just another story that they could have plucked from somewhere else. The idea that Jewish people had about resurrection at this point was something similar to what Jesus had done when he was alive, where he, for example, raised Lazarus from the dead. In every other account of resurrection that they had historically up until this point, what it involved was someone going to pray for the dead person and then raising them in the authority of someone other than himself. So someone like Jesus comes and prays for Lazarus in the name of God and then raises him from the dead. But they had never conceived of a form of resurrection in which someone would come back from their own grave under their own power. And not only that, but escape a tomb that was sealed with a massive boulder and guarded by an entire legion of Roman legionnaires. If we look at Jesus' enemies once again and say, well, what did they say about this? There's something telling in that, because they couldn't produce a body. At no point were the Romans or the Jews able to say, well, look, see, he still is really dead because we have a body. Look at it. They couldn't find one. So regardless of what we believe about this and what it says about Jesus, we have to at least concede that the opponents of Jesus couldn't come up with an empirical explanation of what had happened. This is what a guy called Lee Strobel says about Jesus. Lee Strobel, if you don't know, is a former atheist journalist who used to investigate cold cases. And he decides at one point that he wanted to investigate Jesus and to see, is there really any evidence at all to suggest that this is real? And he says, He says, I'll admit it. I was ambushed by the amount and quality of evidence that Jesus is the unique Son of God. I shook my head in amazement. I had seen defendants carted off to death chambers on much less convincing proof. The cumulative facts and data pointed unmistakably towards a conclusion that I wasn't entirely comfortable in reaching. This is what I think this question comes down for us today, friends. Is not whether or not there's enough evidence to suggest that Jesus is God, because I think there is a lot. It's, are we willing to accept in our own hearts that this is really true? Or does it, like Lee Strobel, make us uncomfortable? Because if we concede that Jesus really is God, it means that every word that he ever spoke is incredibly important. It means that our reaction to him and our response to who he was could have eternal consequences. That makes me uncomfortable. If he isn't a liar and he isn't a lunatic and this is real, then what does that mean for you? What does that mean for me? I'll tell you what it means. It means good news. If Jesus really is God, then that is the best news that you could possibly hear. Because it means that God is not some distant God out there waiting for you to become enlightened enough to prove that your life has worth. It means that God is not some cosmic judge weighing up the good and the bad and seeing whether you make the cut. It means that God is not a stranger who is uninvolved with your life or unfamiliar with your struggles. What it does mean is that no matter all the mistakes of your life, the flaws of who you are, none of it could push God away or keep him back from you. It does mean that God has come near to you and has condescended himself so that he could feel exactly what you feel, so that he could know what your struggles are like, so that he could carry them alongside of you. It means that there really is somebody who has the power and the authority to overcome death itself and rescue you. It means that your life has intrinsic, eternal value to the creator of the universe. So much so that he is willing to come and be rejected by the people he created, called a liar and a lunatic by his own family, and then be carried to a cross and endure one of the most horrific and brutal executions ever devised by human beings so that he could forgive and rescue you. If this is true, there is no better news for you, because it means God loves you. If this is true, there is no better news for us, and so we should not be afraid to wrestle with the answer to this question. Would you guys pray with me as we close this morning? Father, I thank you for your Son. I thank you for this one who has come and drawn near to us, who's shown us your great love for us. I thank you, Lord, that you did not leave us to wrestle this question without providing for us reasons to believe. I thank you, Lord, that you give us the definitive proof at the cross, being willing to endure that. Lord, as we wrestle through this question, would you help us to believe? Would you give us faith to see, Lord, so that we might know you better and know the joy of being loved by you? We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. As we close this morning, I want to remind you, if there's any way that we can pray for you, encourage you, please let us know. We want to pray for you. We love doing that. I want to remind you as well, if you're new, please stop by our welcome desk to pick up your gift. We'd love to hear more from you. But let me offer a benediction. Would you guys stand with me to pray our final benediction? May we go in the name of the God who has sent us his Son, who has walked amongst us, and who has dealt with our pain and our suffering. May we go in the name of that Son. In his name we go. Amen.